Good morning. Our call to worship this morning is Psalm 28, verse 7.
The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and I am helped. My heart leaps for joy, and I will give thanks to him in song. Amen.
Amen. A hearty welcome to each and every one of you on this the third Sunday without Pastor Shannon here, but it's good to see each and every one of you, and we welcome you to, or we encourage you to join in and appreciate all the hard work that Shannon and Dan still have done. They've done one great thing for me. They've put a clock at the back that I can actually see. It's amazing. In the way of announcements, Joe and I want to thank you for your prayers during Joe's emergency surgery on Friday night. The high we were on Friday changed on Saturday morning when the surgeon said he does not think he can save her foot. We'll find out how that is going on Thursday of this week. So once again, we ask you for your prayers. Our God is a great physician. As the song goes, nothing, absolutely nothing is impossible with God. So we put our prayers before his throne of grace. And Joe and I ask you for your prayers as well. That's all I have in the way of announcements, unless I missed anything. Did I miss anything, Nancy? Yep. Okay. This time I would like to lead you in a prayer of invocation. Shall we pray? Father, oh, how you love us to send your one and only Son to die, bringing us hope from despair. Lord, you are our strength and shield, and that is why we gather to worship and praise you. You are our Lord God Almighty, and we can rest secure in the knowledge that you are in control of this world. We thank you for this time of worship we can spend with you and with each other. What a blessed relationship we have as your beloved children, called by you out of pure love and grace, not because of anything that we have done. This morning, as we hear the following songs, we will pay attention to the words and how they impact our walk and dependence on you. Our first song, Oh How He Loves You and Me, points us towards the gift of Calvary. In the same vein, our second song, I Cannot Tell, shows us just what our Savior gave up to come and give us eternal life with him. Our final song speaks of God's love in taking care of us. Wonderful lyrics for us to take home with us. Father, we thank you for the privilege of talking to you in prayer, both corporately and as we will do now silently and personally for a few minutes, shall we pray? The words in our closing song say, no matter what the test, God will take care of you. Father, we thank you for Pastor Gord and the gift you have given him to expound on your written word. Calm our minds, open our ears to comprehend and implement your message for us today entitled, God's Way to Happiness. The Beatitudes are a wonderful passage showing us how to live a Christian life. Father, we do love you. Jesus, we love you. Holy Spirit, we love you. Come fill us with your bountiful love and grace. To you, O Triune God, belong all honor and praise and glory. We pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. This time we will hear number 349, Oh, How He Loves You and Me, and we ask you to stand as you are able. This time I would like to offer a prayer for the collection that has been collected at the back. Shall we pray? Father God, we come to you to thank you. To thank you for the beautiful weather that you've given us. To thank you for this wonderful country that you've given us to live in. Lord, you have blessed us far beyond our means. We thank you for the offering that has been collected. We ask, Lord, as we continue to support this church and the work of the ministry and our missionaries, that you will continue to help each and every one of us. We ask you to bless the hands that have given it. In Jesus' name, amen. Our responsive reading is Philippians 2, verses 1 through 11, and I would like to lead you in the responsive reading at this time. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. In your relationship with others, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ, who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Did I make a mistake? Okay. By taking the very nature of a servant and being made in human likeness, by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth.
And every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, for the glory of God, the Father. Amen.
Amen. This time we once again get to hear a song, and this time it will be number 354, I Cannot Tell. We ask you to stand as you are able. I'd like to lead you in the pastoral prayer, and a reminder, if you do have items for the pastoral prayer, to please contact Nancy or myself, and we will include them in the pastoral prayer. Shall we pray? Father, we come as a congregation before you in our pastoral prayer. Our Bible text this morning states over and over, blessed are. Indeed, we are blessed beyond measure. Blessed to be part of your family. Blessed to have the Holy Spirit guiding us. Blessed to have salvation and redemption from our sins. In our responsive reading, we read, therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and one in mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. Not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interest of others. In your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. Easy words to read, but we tend not to think or live these words. In today's me world, we too can be caught up in the vicious cycle of thinking of ourselves more highly than we should. For we are sinners like our neighbors and friends, and we are in need of your love and forgiveness and grace. Father, we ask you to continue to increase our faith and dependence on you, the source of all good in this world. Father, we thank you for this church family, small in numbers, but big in heart. We thank you for your protection that we have received from the coronavirus. And as we see the numbers increasing worldwide and in our country as well, we pray for those suffering from the effects and those who have lost loved ones. We thank you for the cycle of rain and sunshine and heat for the crops. Be with the farming community worldwide. Lord, we ask that you be with the world leaders. Work in their minds so that they govern fairly and equitably. And Father, we pray for the folks in Haiti. This small, impoverished country is once again recovering from an earthquake and the loss of many lives. Bring comfort into, and we ask you to direct the international aid so it is distributed to those in need. As we look at our church family, we see needs. We ask you to be with those in nursing and retirement homes who cannot attend our services. Be with those under doctor's care or waiting for treatments. You, O Lord, know each need, and we lay them before you, seeking your will, asking that your will be done in each situation. This morning we ask for a blessing on those in the mission field and all those who bring your message of hope to this hurting world. We ask a blessing on the rest of the service and us in the week ahead. Keep Dan and Shannon safe during their vacation, and all of us safe, and give us traveling mercies during this vacation time. Father, have mercy on our souls as we continue to seek you first. Forgive and bless us as we seek your way to happiness. To you, O Lord, we humbly bring honor and glory to your most holy name. We pray through the power of the Holy Spirit and in Jesus' precious name. Amen. At this time, it is my privilege to invite my good friend Gord back to our pulpit. Gord, welcome, and God bless you as you deliver his message.
Thank you, my brother Bob. And we want to encourage you and Jill as well with our continued prayers for you, and Jill's healing and God's strengthening for a very difficult time. I'd like to begin by reading from Matthew chapter 5. Before I do, it's really nice to be back and see wonderful faces of old friends, and some new as well. For those that are visiting or do not know us, Ellie and I attended here for many years before we moved away from the area, and really got to love the folk here, each one of you, and continue to pray God's blessing on you as a church, as you continue to witness to our town of the Lord, the love of the Lord Jesus. Well, Matthew chapter 5, beginning at verse 1. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." I trust this morning's message fits in with our brother Bob's from last week. As we viewed the service last Monday, my wife Ellie and I felt that the Holy Spirit was really speaking, and that we were both searching our own hearts and seeking to apply the truth of God to our own lives. This morning I would like to consider what Jesus taught after he left the multitudes and went to a quiet spot to speak to his disciples. This well-known passage called the Beatitudes is truly a very personal message that he wanted to impress upon the minds and hearts of his disciples. He knew what was going to be ahead of them and of himself, and he wanted to teach them what they really had to have settled and know within themselves. In chapter 4, the previous chapter of Matthew, we read of Jesus' temptation, then of his calling the disciples, preaching and teaching in the synagogues, and healing all kinds of sicknesses and infirmities. The crowds were swarming around, wanting to get a glimpse and perhaps be healed themselves. Jesus wanted these followers, his disciples, to know for sure what that they were about to begin in their lives. He wanted them to be prepared. There are 8 things that Jesus taught these disciples. All of them were based on true happiness that is a total antithesis to that of the world and what it deems as happiness. The world tells us nothing about this type of happiness. Well, we've just watched the Olympics, and I'm sure most of us really rejoiced with all of Canada's athletes and their accomplishments. I hope you were able to watch one American athlete, Simone Biles, who publicly went through a mental breakdown under the pressure to be successful and measure up to the expectations placed upon her when undergoing such scrutiny. Other athletes, even some Canadian ones, expressed similar feelings. If they didn't win, they felt that they were nothing to the Canadian public's eye, even though they competed at their very best and went through all the rigorous training and competition to get there. The world's view of happiness and success is based upon so many empty things. Well, let's take a look at these 8 teachings that Jesus gave. I want to read the first one and then pause to let each of us reflect upon that, and then I want to speak about it following that small silence. The first one: "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Would you let that go through your mind just for a moment and think about it? Scholars tell us that this word blessed is really the root word for happiness. In other words, happy are the poor in spirit. It's an inward condition. It is that assurance and confidence of God's presence. One is at peace with God, or is at rest. This is a real contrast and conflict with what our society presents. If one is poor in spirit, how can he or she be happy? Who experiences this happiness? The poor in spirit. Those who recognize a lack of something in their lives. Those who recognize that their sin and unworthiness before God, and that they have nothing to offer God. Those people are the ones who are happy, because theirs is the kingdom of God. Over and again, in his earthly ministry, Jesus confronted the religious leaders who thought they had everything figured out in their own self-righteousness. He showed them before the disciples that they were on the wrong path. He showed the disciples that they, in turn, could show others. Poor in spirit inherit the kingdom of God. James emphasized this in his letter in chapter 4, verse 8. I'd like to read that to you right now. In James 4 and verse 8. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. God opposes the proud, and he gives grace to the humble. In 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 10, godly soul brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. But worldly sorrow brings death. Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. But worldly sorrow brings death. The poor in spirit then recognize their condition before God, and having recognized who he is, turn to him. And what does God do? He receives them warmly, and he makes them his very own. Theirs is the kingdom of God. Think about that. When we recognize our own sin and failure, when I look at my life and see the terrible things that I thought or did or said, and I come before God, does he say, get out of here, I have no time for you? No. He says, come. You're my very own. I want you. The second beatitude. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Think about that for a moment in your mind. Blessed are those who mourn. This is an emotional condition that results as a recognition of our poverty of spirit. Because we recognize our total lack before God, we mourn. Yes, I too, my own mind, I think back to some things in my life. I mourn. Oh God, forgive me. How could I have said such a thing, or thought such a thing, or have done such a thing? I can't undo it. We're totally saddened by our loss. But it's a genuine repentance. When a person has reached this state, what does God's word say? They shall be comforted I'd like to read from John chapter 14, starting at verse 16. John chapter 14, verse 16. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate or comforter to help you and be with you forever. The Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Wonderful words of comfort and encouragement. That's God speaking to us, to you, to me. What he gives, what he desires in our lives. He would send a comforter. He said, do not let your hearts be troubled. Don't be afraid. There's a wonderful passage that just strikes me from the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians, in chapter 1. And he describes and encourages God's people in this way. Listen to how Paul encourages the Corinthians. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we have ourselves received from God. For just as we share abundantly in the sufferings of Christ, so also our comfort abounds through Christ. If we are distressed, it is for your comfort and salvation. If we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which produces in you patient endurance of the same sufferings we suffer. And our hope for you is firm, because we know that just as you share in our sufferings, so also you share in our comfort. Yes, the Apostle Paul was speaking about some of the sufferings that he had to endure in his life. Terrible things. Beatings, he said. Imprisonment, he said. Mocking and scorning, he said. But he said, that's so I can encourage you. And it's going to happen to you so that you can encourage others. So be comforted by God and share your comfort with others. The next beatitude. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Think about that for a moment. Who are the meek? They are the ones who are obedient to Christ the King. They're not those who are pushed around. No, their strength is found in self-control. They don't seek retribution or vengeance. They have an absolute willingness to submit unto Christ. As one New Testament commentator said, it is a spirit of true humility which is unconscious of humility. It is like Christ himself who said, come unto me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am gentle and humble of heart, and you will find rest for your souls. They will inherit the earth. This is what Psalm 37, verse 4 says. It gives a very good understanding. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. We can be meek in any situation because we know that God watches over us. There's a new creation coming when Jesus returns. And he promised a new heaven and a new earth. And it is the meek who will inherit it. The next beatitude. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Those that recognize that the world without God has nothing to offer. It is not power, control, success, or comfort that we're to yearn for, but rather it is righteousness. They are the ones who really yearn for what God desires for people. It is a passion for God's kingdom. It is a desire for faith in Jesus the Christ to enter all people. It is a sadness for any loss of life due to tragedy or sin. It is a deep desire for personal righteousness. These people will be filled. They won't be disappointed. They will be completely satisfied, for they will see God's righteousness in sin defeated at the cross. The next beatitude. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. I would like to read in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 to 10. Well-known passage, I'm sure we're all familiar with verse 8. Ephesians chapter 2, beginning at verse 4. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is his gift of God. Not by works so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. God has redeemed us and made us his own. And now we have something to do. His good works. Blessed are they merciful. The works of mercy. Mercy that says and sees and understands. There's a world that doesn't acknowledge nor recognize Jesus Christ. Let's share him with that world. Let's share him in every way that we can. By our voices. By our words, through our prayer life, through our desires for those people. Also, let's consider what Jesus said in the Gospel of Luke in chapter 10. And I find this very striking because it's not one of the apostles writing. It's Jesus himself speaking. What did he say? In Luke in chapter 6. Beginning at verse 35. But love your enemies, do good to them, and lend to them without expecting to get anything back. Then your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High, because he is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. Boy, in 2021, in our society, that had its own, doesn't it? That's a tall task that Jesus has asked of me and of you. But that's what he asked. That's what he taught the disciples. Those were his very words. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown merciful. Our God is a merciful God who desires mercy in us. As we are merciful, so God shows his mercy to us. Mercy is shown in forgiveness, always thinking more highly of others, and having regard for the weaker and poorer. What a challenge. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Think about it for a moment. The pure in heart. These are the ones who are totally loyal to Jesus and truly want to reflect his spirit. Our motives and desires are pure. Honesty and integrity become rooted in life. There is an undivided heart toward God. It's just as the psalmist prayed in Psalm 51:10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. They shall see God in Scripture. They shall see God in creation all around us. They shall see God in the family of faith, other Christian believers. They shall see God each day as they talk to him and listen to him. That's one of the hard things for me, to listen to what God is saying. So much busyness in our lives, so many other things to do. So many things in our minds and our hearts that we want. We don't take the time to listen to what God is saying. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the sons of God. It is God himself who made peace through the cross. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 14, really sets it out. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two one, and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing in his flesh the law with its commandments and regulations. His purpose was to create one new man out of the two, making peace, and in his body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, which he put to death their hostility. It is God who establishes peace and puts his character in us. By being peacemakers, we are reflecting God's own character. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Did you notice in this beatitude, it goes right back to the first one? For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We know how the world treated Jesus. In our own culture, we see how the world responds to believers who truly want to witness to his gospel. I hope you're praying for Afghanistan today. You realize if there's even a whisper that you or I might be a Christian and we live there, just that, hey, those people are Christian. They immediately have a death penalty from the Taliban. And the same attitude goes throughout much of the world. But I want us to reflect very carefully. In our own culture, as we see how the world responds to believers who truly want to witness to his gospel, I know that history reveals some terrible things supposedly done in the name of Jesus, and the people perpetrating these terrible things will be justly judged. But I trust that by reading this passage, we can see the difference. Ellie and I have had the wonderful experience of being loved by the people of Neoshinami and the community of Waggamaw Lake in the far north of Ontario. We are deeply ashamed of what we have heard regarding the residential school system. Yes, I had some adults at Neoshinami share with me their horrible, horrible experiences at a residential school. It was awful what they shared with me. Yet there are members of these communities who have looked past the terrible presentation of Jesus and looked to the true Jesus of Scripture, who embodies completely his Heavenly Father and what the gospel truly is. Yes, the world will seek to tear the gospel apart and will attack its messengers. Paul the Apostle was aware of this and warned his readers in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12. But happy are they, for God has something wonderful in the present. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. I trust that we can present the true love and compassion of God presented through the gospel of Jesus Christ, not what the world seeks to interpret to be, but what it really is, in these qualities that Jesus sought to instruct his disciples. For each one, there really is a true happiness. So I ask, in conclusion, what is your happiness? There is nothing that can compare to the happiness that God gives. As grandparents, Ellie and I are very happy to see our grandchildren. We love them dearly. To see our children. To see what they've been able to accomplish in their lives thus far. I'm sure there are many, many things that are similar in your lives that bring you such joy. Happiness. There's nothing that can compare to the happiness that God gives. Last week, our brother Bob presented to us that it is personal. Yes, it is. Jesus took his disciples aside to teach them these very personal things. He wanted to prepare them for what was ahead, so that they would be able to endure. He wanted them to keep their eyes on the goal or prize that was ahead. They had seen Jesus perform miracles, challenge the spiritual leaders around them, and be so loving and accepting to those in such dire need, whether spiritually or physically. He patiently showed his love and promise to all people. we seek and receive and live in the happiness that Jesus gives. In the beginning, I ask that we pause after the reading of each beatitude. Now I ask you to reflect on your own life as I reflect on my own. Am I poor in spirit? Do I have confidence in God's promise that I am part of the kingdom of heaven? Do I mourn over sin and offense against God? Have I experienced God's comfort? Do I exhibit meekness in my life? Am I satisfied with the things that God gives? Is there a real thirst for righteousness in my life? Am I truly satisfied in it? Is my life filled with mercy in my outlook and actions? Do I receive God's mercy? Do I really seek peace around me? Do I truly identify as a child of God? Have I experienced rejection or persecution because of my faith? Again, am I joyful because of my citizenship in God's kingdom? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the Lord Jesus. Thank you for what he's taught. Help us to learn these lessons. Help us to truly reflect in a world that is such need. Forgive us for failing. Forgive us for showing your wrong identity of Jesus. Forgive us for following things that really were not right. And help us to reflect the love and mercy and grace of the Lord Jesus, that others may experience the wonderful happiness that's found in him and found in the truths that he has taught. And I would pray in Jesus' name. Well, we're going to join once again in special music, God Will Take Care of You. Let's stand as we continue in worship. Peace of Christ, may the love of Christ, may the truth of Christ show in our lives as we seek to love others and to share him. May God bless you.